play along with me. So you're both arrested and you're put into the system. And during intake, you answer some questions about your background, where you live, your job, your family situation, etc. Ultimately, you're each arraigned before the same judge. You hear the other person's charges, and then you hear the judge say, "You're four, $5,000 bond. Next." Then it's your turn, and you hear the charges, which are identical to the person in front of you, and you hear the judge say, "You're an eight, $75,000 bond. Next." Wouldn't you be confused, upset, even outraged? Especially when the court not only says they aren't giving you an answer as to what is an eight, why you are an eight, or why is your bail so high compared to the other person. The court says you are not even entitled to know. This is happening in courtrooms every day in this country thanks to the marvel of artificial intelligence, or AI models. Now, these AIs are attempting to predict the risk of someone either committing another crime while being out on bail or being a flight risk to not appear in court. This is one usage of AI that I'm familiar with because I've spent the last 7 years studying the intersections of law and technology. Now, AIs are popping up everywhere and in almost everything. Children's toys, writing music, personalized marketing, self-driving cars, fraud detection, reading x-rays, and the list goes on and on and on. Just about anything automated you can verbally interact with, Alexa, Google, Siri, has some sort of AI behind it. There's even now a new sector of AIs called generative AI, and we'll talk about those in a minute, but let's get back to a major issue with artificial intelligence. One major concern in the development of AIs is bias. Now, bias, in its most general sense, means slant. But bias in this case refers to systems that can make decisions against certain individuals or groups of individuals in favor of others. Consider this example. When you create an AI, it knows nothing. It has to be taught. Now, we teach AIs by feeding them a specialized set of data called training data. And this training data is the type of information we want the AI to make decisions on and for which we already know the correct answers. This allows the model to learn what's a correct prediction and what's an incorrect prediction based on feedback we give it about the training data set. Now, this is where historical bias in the data itself can be unwillingly introduced to the model. Let's take three hypothetical cities. City A, people of color make up 67% of the population, but they account for 85% of the police stops. City B, 54% of the ethnic population experience 85% of the police stops. Or City C, their ethnic population is 53% of the city, but 83% of the police stops. Now, can you imagine what happens to an AI system that's fed this training data? Who does it learn to trust? Who does it learn to distrust? Can you see how slanted data can lead to slanted results? Well, what if I told you these cities are not hypothetical? Instead, they are Ferguson, Missouri, Newark, New Jersey, and New York City. Now, while you marinate on those thoughts for a moment, let's resume our conversation on generative AIs. Now, generative AI refers to deep learning models that can generate high-quality text, images, and other content based on the data they're trained on. This raises some new and interesting issues in two different areas of law, copyright law and criminal law. Now, copyright law is a type of intellectual property. It protects individual and original works of authorship like books, songs, photographs, etc. And as soon as an author fixes that work in a tangible form of expression, it's then protected by copyright. Now, this current crop of generative AIs can generate some amazing things based on a prompt or some feeder data. You can, with the correct prompts, write books, movies, theater scripts, poetry, or even song lyrics. Provide the right AI 5 to 10 pictures of yourself, and it can generate 100 headshots in a variety of different backgrounds. Request a certain style of music, ask for a blend of several different musical genres and have that AI write a song or 10 for you. Sounds like a wonderful, brave new world, right? So let me pose you a question. Who's the author of those books, those plays, those photos, those songs? An author under copyright law is generally considered to be the person or persons who created the work. But legally, AI is not a person. The person creating the prompt or feeding the images or music samples didn't actually produce what was generated by the AI. So who's the copyright owner? The prompter? The programmer? The company commercially exploiting the AI? Let's look into the criminal law aspects of all this. And again, I'm afraid I have to ask you to imagine yourself to be possible bad guys. How might you exploit these new technologies to your potential gain? You happen to know that if you can get 3 seconds of someone's voice, you can get an AI to recreate that voice and have it say whatever you want it to say. So let's call someone's child and record 5 seconds of conversation with them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now let's feed that to the voice generator AI. Call the child's parents and have the AI say, "Hey, mom, dad, I'm applying for XYZ. And I forgot my social security number." Or worse, let's have the AI tell them, "Mom and dad, I've been kidnapped. If you send a ransom here, they'll let me go." AI filters already exist that can alter a person's looks and features in real time as a camera or an app is recording video. This is already happening. What this means for the law is that several normally strong pieces of evidence in criminal trials, photos, videos, audio recordings, will no longer be the incontrovertible and irrefutable items that we've considered them to be before now. The law will have to catch up to the technology as it usually does, and it needs to do so fairly quickly. The bad guys are normally way ahead of the lawmakers. At its core, AI is software. Software shaped by the minds and the experiences of the programmers who create it. So the program adopts the programmer's worldview to some extent. Being aware of bias in our viewpoints and being conscious to not allow it into our software design and development is one small way we can attack these issues. Brainstorming what the technology might be capable of and getting ahead of it instead of running to catch up to it with our laws, rules, and regulations is another. And I'm certain some of you are asking yourselves right now, well, what does he want me to do about it? I'm not a programmer. So glad you asked. One thing we must do is understand and document the bias and the risk of bias in AI systems. For example, New York City, their city council passed a resolution to form a task force to look into the impacts of AI in government decision making. Next, I need you to be involved with your political leaders at all levels, local, state, national. This will be vital because lawmakers are going to have to set the current and future standards for how AI is managed. Last, no matter your technical background, become engaged and involved in the conversation. Go and educate yourselves. Whenever you see a decision-making system, ask yourself questions like, is there an AI involved here? Where is the data? Could it be biased? What's the outputs of these systems? Is it fair to everybody? Whenever you see a picture, watch a video, or even read a book, think about the source of the information that you're consuming. So as you can see, this is truly everybody's problem because you don't know when you're going to be facing down this. So my expectation for your behavior going forward is to be alert for the presence of AIs, to be part of the conversation to challenge and change them, and to be influencers of the pathways to the political and technological solutions needed. Well, why is that my expectation? Well, there's a principle in our legal system that says we cannot hold people accountable for adhering to a standard of behavior if we've never put them on notice of what that standard is. I expect your adherence to my expectations because I have now put you on notice. Know about AI because it definitely knows about you. Thank you.